Are you comfortable being wrong? You know, what I mean by this is we all have opinions, we all have ideas all day long. And every now and then we get things wrong. But for fans of popular culture, and comic books in particular, being wrong sometimes seems very, very difficult for people to accept. Let's talk about it. Hey there, this is Perch. One of the things that I think has always been true of comics, and I'm talking now from the perspective of somebody who's heard a lot of arguments in the comic book store about one thing or another. And sometimes those arguments are subjective, like, you know, who's the better character, Superman or Silver Surfer? And sometimes there's a mix of kind of facts and subjective, like who's the more powerful character, Superman or Silver Surfer, where parts of that are a subjective interpretation of facts, but there is some actual data that could tell us right or wrong which way it goes. And then some things are just factual, like when was Superman created? What year? When was the first Silver Surfer comic published? What year? And I find that people's happiness in comics is often equated to their ability to accept that sometimes they get it wrong. Now, I'll give you an example for myself. I pronounce names terribly. So if you've been listening to this channel for any length of time, you've heard me butcher nearly everyone's name in the industry to the point that it's almost a joke. And if I'm being honest, sometimes I deliberately do this as a joke. And sometimes I just don't remember or say things poorly or my mouth gets way ahead of my brain. Happens all the time. But I remember having an argument with somebody, not a heated argument, not a passion argument, about Bill Sienkiewicz. And I was convinced his name was pronounced Bill Sienkiewicz. And I said, no, I've heard other people say this. I'm still convinced I have heard other people say this in the industry. And I've heard Bill say this. Now, there's a case where I was wrong, clearly wrong, but my brain was telling me, my memory was telling me that I'd heard it from him somehow. So finally, going to a convention, meeting the guy, and realizing his name was Bill Sienkiewicz, I had to admit I was wrong. And I think it's healthy when you have those moments because it gives you more of a perspective of being able to interpret, first of all, when something's a fact and when there's a right or wrong answer to it, or when there's something that's subjective where people may argue passionately, but there's no real way to determine who's right and who's wrong in the end. It all is what matters to you. This is an interesting challenge with comics because certainly in the last, I would say, 5 years or so, but it's been true always of the internet. If you went back to the old Usenet boards in the early 90s, you would see these same kind of arguments going on, where when presented with facts and when presented with the clear fact that somebody was wrong about something, like, you know, Wolverine was not a founding member of the X-Men. I remember this as a real argument. Somebody said, yep, Wolverine has always been, he was a founding member of the X-Men. Now, this isn't a debatable topic. This, you know from the X-Men that it was Beast, it was Iceman, it was Angel, it was Marvel Girl, and it was Havoc. No, I'm just screwing with you. It was Cyclops. And that was the original five-member team of the X-Men. If you want to get picky about it, you can say Professor X was also a member of that team. He was kind of the leader or the mentor. And so that was the X-Men team. Wolverine came along much later in giant size X-Men, and in terms of being with the team, he had appeared in the Hulk before that. There are facts. We know this from actual dates, actual proof. Yet, I watched somebody argue this into the ground, and even when presented with images of X-Men number one and proof that these were the five characters, he would say, well, but technically, that's not modern X-Men. I was talking about the Jim Lee issue of X-Men, the X-Men number one, where you know the blue and gold teams got started. It's like, well, but no, you weren't. That's not, you know, that doesn't mean founding member of the X-Men. And then it kind of transitioned into, well, because he was born before any of those people, technically he's the oldest member, so that makes him. People just start splitting hairs and getting into very weird kind of side arguments over what language means. And I think you know, one, if you're that person, it's best to know, just get comfortable with the idea that you can say, hey, I made a mistake on that one. I was wrong. You'll be happier. And guess what? 95% of the time, the vast majority of the time, the person you're arguing with or the people around you will be gracious. In fact, I will tell you, I have gained more support over my life and my career, and certainly on Twitter, even in the last 2 years, even with this highly polarized, environment that we have. I will tell you, some of the biggest moments where I've gained followers or gained respect is when I've said something, I was wrong, I admitted I was wrong, and people are like, hey, cool of you to admit you're wrong. And also, there's usually one jackass who comes in and goes, ah, ha, 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 ha. And they just want to gloat and they kind of want to pee all over the floor like an excited puppy when they've won. And what's interesting is in those moments, that person, the person gloating and pumping their fist in the air, they don't look like a winner. They look like a fool. And you look like the adult. You look like the more responsible, reasonable one. I can't tell you how many times I've gained followers, I've gained respect, and I've gained good friends through this process of just being comfortable admitting you're wrong. The other aspect of it is, if you're in an argument where somebody is wrong and you know they're wrong, the facts, like the Wolverine example, you know there's clear facts and this person is just denying reality, there's no point to keeping going with the argument. Know when to say, all right, cool. You're welcome to believe what you want to believe. I'm going to just go over here now because I've said my piece. There's no value in keeping going and going and going and driving into the ground. You're not going to get to that aha moment. Now, hopefully people will say, hey, they make a case, they're wrong, you prove they're wrong, and they go, oh, I see I was wrong. I learned something today. Cool. And that's a great outcome. But generally speaking, if you present your case and somebody starts going through very weird kind of mechanics to justify how they're right in some kind of tilted version of the world, they're screwing with you. They're not screwing with you. This is just somebody who's never going to come to that realization. And so you're best to just get out, stop wasting your time, move on. I think that there's a lot of opportunities in comics to make friends, build community, learn things, grow, and all the rest. And a lot of it stems from just accepting. It's inner peace. We'll meditate here on this. It is accepting the fact that with all these stats and all this information, you're going to be wrong sometimes. And there's nothing shameful about that. Bringing it home to kind of a more pro approach, I've had discussions with Tom Brevoort at times, where he's been wrong. And this is a guy who kind of champions himself as being the all-knowing, nobody can beat him at trivia, he knows Marvel better than anyone. And to his credit, the guy knows a ton. It's not like this is some, you know, flaky kind of poser. He knows a lot, more than 99% of people, I'm sure. But he does get it wrong sometimes, and he's been proven wrong. And in those cases, which are rare, he turns into a complete absolute jackass. I'm just saying he does not lose gracefully. And if I think about what I've heard, not from fans, but from his peers in the industry, from other editors or from other creators or other people who talk about their experience with Tom, whenever they point to something negative, every single time, it's not that he cheated him on a contract or that he made them change a story in the way they didn't like. Those are very rare stories. I mean, there's a couple people complain about that, but very rare to the point of not real. The thing that everyone always brings up is when the guy is wrong, he digs in and pouts and kind of reverts to an 8-year-old version of himself. And it's off-putting. People, like, when they see that, they don't want to be hanging out with 8-year-olds. And so it's interesting how no matter who you are in any point of the industry, fan, retailer, comic pro, industry veteran, whatever it happens to be, the ability to say, huh, I was wrong about that, is often this barrier between success and failure in the eyes of everyone else. Think about it. Just an interesting observation from this wacky, crazy world of comics. Anyway, hey, did you like what you hear? This is not comic related, it's more psychology, personal related. But if you liked it, please give me a like, subscribe. Your subscriptions help me know that you care. Mostly it's good to just spread the word. And I'm grateful to each and every one of you that has subscribed. So thank you if you have. If you wouldn't mind, love to have you. Otherwise, follow me on Twitter, Comic Perch, and thanks for listening.
So we've had a lot of talking in this comic. What do you think of comics that talk a lot?
They're not good.
Not good. You are not a Brian Michael Bendis fan. That's what I'm getting here, right here.